And that was our Lady of Gooseberry Shortcake Children's Choir in Derbyshire, New Hampshire, via satellite.
Just the first of many such cutting-edge, high-tech entertainments we have planned this evening on the Rubber Chicken St. Christmas Day Jamboree. I'm Andre Summers, daughter of kings.
And I'm Jim Morrison. Wait, sorry, hang on, that was a typo on the teleprompter. That should say Tim Morrison.
You're not going to be Jim Morrison?
Oh, should I actually answer that?
Well, if you're not going to be Jim Morrison, can I be Jim Morrison?
You already said you were Andre Summers.
So what? It's the radio. What do they know? Watch this. I'm Andre Summers.
And I'm John Lennon.
Oh, whoa. Wow, Mr. Lennon, this is terribly awkward. I've always wanted to meet you, especially after your brutal murder, but this is a close set, and we're right in the middle of... Oh, wait. That was you, wasn't it?
Yeah, you see what I did there?
Well, that was fantastic. I couldn't believe that you did that. That's
Guys,
amazing.
Guys, focus, please.
Sorry, that was Fiona. And tonight on our Candid St. Crispin's Day Jamboree, she's in the kitchen preparing a traditional St. Crispin's Day feast.
Fiona, why don't you describe for us what you've been doing in there for the past 16 hours?
Well, Tim, to tell you the truth, I only got here about 5 minutes ago. As a local celebrity, I don't really do any of the grunt work, much like yourself. I'm paid to banter and show off my rack.
Your...
I think she's talking about the rack of lamb. Fiona, who's been doing the cooking if not you?
For that, we pay $6 an hour to a prep cook named Ying. Say hello, Ying.
Hiya.
You know he used to be an admiral?
Look, Fiona, could you at least describe the kind of food you're meant to be preparing?
Sure. It's all on this index card I was given by the stage manager. Here we have the traditional St. Crispin's Day moose head, garnished with carameled apples and cilantro. To its immediate left, the cherry sandwiches commemorating the night St. Crispin hid from the goatmen in the cherry grove and made a beautiful wreath out of them for his lady love, Maid Linda.
Fiona, we all know the history. Just stick to the ingredients, huh?
Fine. Here on the right, we have a punch bowl filled with a mix of fig cider and maudite. Traditionally, of course, sherry was used, but this cue card says that I find maudite gives it an extra kick.
That's great, Fiona, but is Ying okay? He does seem to be flailing around a little bit.
He's fine. His pacemaker just gets a little finicky when he's near the microwave.
All right, Fiona, we'll come back to you later in the show, as it seems our first guest has arrived. You may have seen him getting ejected from the Enfield Morning Show for politicizing earlier this week, but I know him a little more personally, as he's also been my local parish priest since I was just a boy. Please welcome Father Albert Long. Father, welcome.
It's good to see you, my boy.
Now, Father, as Andre said, you were recently ejected from the Enfield Morning Show, and in fact, countless other shows throughout the holiday season. Could you explain why?
It's because of the things I want to talk about. They're the things people don't want to hear.
But that's the plight of all old people, though, isn't it?
No, look. This is the St. Crispin's Day season, right? And what does that mean to kids? What are we brought up thinking St. Crispin's Day is about?
Presents?
Exactly. The St. Crispin's Day wolf comes down your chimney with a reindeer full of gifts for the whole family and puts them in your shoes. But do you think kids are even aware of what the holiday is really about?
Presents?
Why does a St. Crispin's Day wolf wear shoes on his paws? Why is he even a wolf? Children these days are not taught that St. Crispin killed his twin brother and then was devoured by wolves. They don't even know St. Crispin was a shoemaker. The whole celebration has been hijacked by pop culture and big business. Did you know that Barama Shanti, the Indian boy, was actually invented by the Coca-Cola Company?
Honestly, though, I'm a little confused. If St. Crispin's Day is about celebrating how he killed his brother and then got devoured by wolves, I mean... should we be celebrating that?
It's history! If we don't celebrate it, what's the point?
Fair enough. So, Father, what steps is the church taking to bring the holiday back to its roots?
We've made plans to firebomb a Walmart.
Okay! Unfortunately, that's all the time we have for that interview.
Yeah. Let's go live to the Tacoma Dome now, where Halliburton is holding a special St. Crispin's Day telethon, granting the wishes of sick children and providing relief from Hurricane Katrina.
People still need relief from that?
No, but it generates good buzz for Halliburton.
Oh, okay. Well, anyway, here's the telethon host, reality show winner, Tame N. Fuck One.
Motherfucker, it's time on Fuck One, baby! You know what I'm saying?
I think so.
Yeah, I know what he's saying. He's correcting you or something, right?
Now you know what's cooking, baby doll.
And now he's... what? He's cooking a doll. Is he?
Taimon, why don't you give us an update on how the telethon's going?
Shit, son, this motherfucker is off the hook for real, man. You know what's happening.
What hook?
The hook, nigga. What's wrong with you?
I think I'm getting a headache.
You told me about a hook.
Halliburton peace interact over a period of 10 or so profitable years. Nigga.
Okay, let's get back to him later. Taimon, we'll get back to you later.
Ah, word, baby.
Our next guest is not here yet.
We're professionals. We'll muddle along.
Okay. I know a joke about rape.
Fiona! How are things going in the kitchen?
I don't know.
You don't know!
I haven't been in the kitchen for a while.
Just pretend you're in the kitchen then, please.
All right, fine. Here. I'm killing an animal and removing its skin.
That's pretty good. She's good at that.
Talk about the St. Crispin's Day feast. How's that coming?
Stuff's cooking.
Is she acting now? Because I really believe that stuff is cooking.
Why don't you come back to me later? I gotta make a call.
You're not actually supposed to have a phone in here.
I'm a local celebrity.
Yeah, and $5,000 well spent that was.
Speaking of money down a toilet, our next guest has just joined us in our cozy firelit studio.
A controversial writer, producer, and director operating outside the so-called Hollywood system. His name is Hal Rankin, and he has recently been under fire for the negative portrayal of both wolves and shoemakers in his latest highly personal St. Crispin biopic entitled The Ardor of the Saint.
Hal, welcome to the show.
Well, thank you, Andre.
Oh, please.
Would you control yourself?
No, it's okay. I get this all the time. Let me guess, Tim. You have wolves in your family.
Shoemakers.
Whatever. Look, I'd just like to clear up right away that my film doesn't portray anything that wasn't already written in the Bible. I have plenty of friends who are shoemakers, and it's not necessarily anti-lupine to remind people that wolves did devour our Lord.
Fair point.
Yeah, well, what about that news footage of you getting pulled over for drunk driving and screaming about how shoemakers are evil and run the media?
Oh, well, that was at night.
What do you mean it was at night?
Well, it was.
He's right, Tim. It was at night.
Who cares if it was at night? The guy's movie is anti-lupine, anti-shoemaker propaganda.
Hey, I'm not the first to portray shoemakers negatively in the media. Geppetto and Pinocchio? Shades of pedophilia. And what about Married with Children? That man was an idiot.
Hey, Al Bundy represented Middle America.
Plus, he was a shoe salesman. Those people have never worked a day in their lives.
Well, that sounds kind of discriminatory, too, but I guess it's a paradox, so it's okay.
I think what we should really be talking about is what a positive message my film sends to children.
But it's like 3 hours of a guy being brutally murdered. There's a razor whip.
Hey, the church loved it.
Fair enough.
What I'd like to hear from you right now, Mr. Rankin, is a balanced, well-reasoned defense of the allegations that your film is a masturbatory, uber-violent reel of anti-shoemaker, anti-lupine Christian propaganda.
Okay, think about this. If my movie portrayed shoemakers negatively, why would the shoemakers that control the media let me make it?
Yeah, right, that makes sense, I guess.
So, Hal, what's your next film going to be about?
A race of godless people whose lack of faith in our Lord ultimately leads to the collapse of their civilization.
I heard it's a chase movie.
Oh, it is.
Hal Rankin, everyone.
Now, why don't we check back in with Taimon Fuquan at the Tacoma Dome to see how much money Halliburton has raised for the kids.
Taimon, what was the name of that reality show you won again?
Baby, that shit was called First Out of the Hood, you know what I'm saying? I was the first of 12 contestants to finish night school and get a high school equivalency certificate, motherfucker. You know what's happened? I'm fresh out of that, motherfucker.
Great. Sounds like your life's right on track.
Motherfucker, I sell crack to kids, man. I'm a fucking crack dealer, motherfucking hustler. You know what I'm saying, man?
Speaking of kids, how much money have you guys made for them so far?
We got the Benjamins rolling in here like it ain't no fair, Junior.
Did you say number? Was that how they say numbers?
Maybe, I don't know.
Halliburton, if peak oil is out there, we'll find it.
Taimon, we'll come back to you.
Well, right now, why don't we address the delicious smell that's coming out of the kitchen? Fiona, what is that delightful aroma?
Would you like the sashimi?
What? Ying-wes, Fiona.
Uh-oh, something awful isn't having a St. Crispin's Day special.
I would have heard of you. The finest California roll.
Ying, answer me.
Fiona.
Yes, where's Fiona?
Pearl Harbor.
Maybe I should unplug that microwave.
Okay, never mind. Let's just soldier on. And speaking of soldiers, we can technically get our next guest on the phone whenever we want. So why don't we just do it right now?
If it's Morty Beckbaum, I'm slitting my other wrist.
It's not Morty Beckbaum.
Okay, I might have jumped the gun a little bit. Where's the first aid kit?
Joining us right now via satellite is Private First Class Billy Bob Sinclair, live from a U.S. Army supply column in Fallujah, Iraq.
Billy Bob, can you hear us?
Yes, sir.
See, you don't get respect like that outside the army anymore.
Pavlovian conditioning isn't the same thing as respect.
What are you talking about, Pavlovian conditioning? He's not salivating. Billy Rob, you're not salivating, are you?
No, sir, I'm no longer capable. My saliva glands were removed after a friendly fire incident earlier this month.
Fantastic. Billy Bob, why don't you tell us how you and the boys are getting ready for St. Crispin's Day this year?
Well, sir, we have a plan in place for a feast of sorts. For the past 6 months, our boys have been confiscating all civilian food supplies and stockpiling them in our barracks to guarantee the entire corps a hearty feast on St. Crispin's Day.
Doesn't starving civilians kind of clash with the positive message of St. Crispin's Day?
Well, we all have to make sacrifices.
Sounds festive.
So, are you involving the locals in your celebrations?
Oh, yeah, we're having a great time over here.
Because we have some disturbing photos of the kinds of things going on in your camp. I was wondering if you could explain to me what we're seeing here on this image.
I don't see why this is necessary. They're probably just team-building exercises.
Indulge me. Like here in this photo, we see a pyramid of naked men with wires attached to their testicles, and a soldier is in the foreground giving a thumbs up.
Those are just the willing participants in the lighting of the St. Crispin's tree. Needless to say, the arid conditions of the desert don't provide for the traditional elm tree, so we had to make do with the configuration of local gymnasts, who were then electrified at a perfectly safe amperage. It was highly festive, as you can probably tell from the grinning face of the pictured soldier. Good times were had by all.
Okay. In this photo, a man dressed in rags is standing on a box with his arms extended and a bag over his head.
Well, that's just the closest thing we had to a shoemaker costume. And standing on a box, that guy's pretending to be St. Crispin, trying desperately to reach high ground and avoid being put in stress positions by the wolves.
Uh-huh. What about this final photo we've got of people being tossed into a mass grave?
Oh, those are prisoners of war who are tortured and executed.
You're just going to admit that?
Why would I lie to you? It's against the spirit of the holidays.
I'm not worried you'll be tried for war crimes.
That's against the spirit of the holidays, too.
Do you want to maybe cut to the telethon?
I think I just want to be alone for a minute.
Time on. How are things at the Tacoma Dome?
What you say, motherfucker?
I'm just asking how the fundraising's going, man.
Oh, good, money good. I just heard from a nigga dog, Pimp Killer. Him and his crew jacked the truck full of flat screens, yo. And all that shit for the kids.
Okay. What about the phones, though? Is anything coming in on the phones?
Straight, son, straight. My nigga BD offered to buy the whole crate for 40 kilos of yay, dog. You know what's happening, nigga?
Tim, take over. I'm confused and frightened.
Halliburton, we own countries you ain't even heard of.
Timer, isn't there supposed to be one lucky child whose St. Crispin's Day wish your telethon grants tonight?
You said it, motherfucker. This shit's for real. Say hi, player, dog. Little Simon, and he's 8 years old, man, but he already has the bones of a pensioner.
Would it be tasteless if I screamed, "Where does he keep them?" and then rolled on the floor laughing till I hyperventilated?
Yes. Simon, tell us, what's your St. Crispin's Day wish?
I want to meet Crispin.
The St. Crispin's Day wolf?
Yay!
I guess that's a yes. Are you on that, Simon?
Nigga, I've been clean for 5 fucking hours, baby. We rolling in this nuggle.
Well, at least we all understand each other.
Have we found Fiona yet? I'm not going to have Ying try to explain what he's cooking. That'd be rating suicide.
Why don't we try her cell phone?
Okay. If that doesn't work, we can try her mobile.
And that's how you do cultural humor without being racist, kids!
This better be important.
Fiona, where the hell are you?
I just had to step out for a while to a prior commitment.
Is that Happy Birthday being sung in the background?
I'm just at the mayor's 56-acre ranch celebrating his birthday with an intimate gathering of 1,000 or so close friends.
We're paying you to be here.
Yes, but the mayor is a close friend of mine. I just couldn't miss his Diamond Jubilee.
Diamond Jubilee? Doesn't that mean he's been married for 60 years?
No, it's celebrating the 60 years he's reigned as mayor. We could just do this segment over the phone, can't we?
We must.
So, how are things going in the kitchen, Fiona?
They're cutting the cake. I have to go.
Consummate professionalism.
You think it's a cheesecake?
All right, that's it. I'm driving over there and I'm bringing her back in the trunk if I have to.
You think they're cutting a cheesecake?
Ridiculous. You can do the next segment yourself.
Tim!
What?
Do you think they are cutting a cheesecake?
I don't know. Why? Why does it matter?
If you get there and you see that they are, make sure you remember to make a sweet joke about cutting the cheese.
Fine.
And credit me!
Whatever!
Ah, hilarious. Baby.
It's good stuff.
Sorry, are we on the air yet?
What? Oh, yeah, crap, right. Sitting with me now is our next guest. His name is Don White, and a few years ago he wrote an unjustifiably popular novel called The Picasso Papers. Don, why don't you tell us a bit about the premise for that book?
Well, Andre, the narrative centers around a fictional character who is sort of like a really hip, sexy version of me. And you see, he discovers that inside the paintings of Picasso is hidden a sort of code, you see, that leads him to uncover history's best kept secret.
And could you tell us what that secret is without spoiling the end of the book?
Well, no, obviously.
Huh. See, that's going to make the rest of this segment a little awkward, because sitting with us also is historian Leah Hansen, and she claims that the secret in your novel is actually a great big rip-off of most of her research. Is that right, Leah?
That's right, Andre. All of this was documented 15 years ago in my book, The Descendants of...
Leah, sorry, this is awkward, but I'm not actually going to be able to let you say the title of your book, because it would spoil the plot of Don's book.
I don't care if his plot gets spoiled. He's passing my findings off as his.
Technically not the case. He's passing your findings off as fiction that he made up.
How is that better?
Let me just interject here. Let's not forget that my novel is not taking credit for any historical findings. What it's doing is drawing upon the latest cutting-edge research to fuel a fast-paced, ultimately shallow plot structure that would adapt easily into 120 pages of screenplay and disseminate like wildfire as an airport paperback.
But in stealing fuel for his wildfire, Mr. White has taken rough, unsubstantiated research and portrayed it as fact. This is the real issue, that my work is not only going uncredited, it's also being misrepresented. Churchgoers are terrified now about things that may not even be real.
Well, to be fair, that's generally the case no matter what.
Michael Crichton wrote a book about a dinosaur theme park that was based on the latest DNA research and amber preservation. He didn't see people terrified that dinosaurs were coming back.
Okay, I'm going to stop you there because I've read neither of your books and have lost all ability to follow this conversation.
So, what are we supposed to talk about?
All right, fine. Spoil it.
Excuse me?
Spoil your book. Let me hear the ending. What are we arguing about here?
Okay, if you like. My book suggests that Saint Crispin had a family and did not get devoured by wolves as a virgin. It suggests that he had descendants and a secret society has been protecting their bloodline for generations.
Oh, that's what my research suggests. He's stolen those hypotheses and pretended that they're true.
In his fiction, though.
Well, yes.
He's pretending that they're true in his fiction?
Yes.
No, I'm just as confused as I was before.
Well, thanks to you, I'm getting a little confused, too.
He's pretending that things that may be fictional are fictional.
But they may be true.
Which is what his fiction is saying.
But not as true as his fiction is saying.
Can I just jump in here and remind everyone that I look a little bit like Harrison Ford?
Okay, this is ridiculous. I told them we should have gotten the albinos instead.
Excuse me?
Albinos hate his book, too. They think it unfairly portrays them as self-flagellating monsters.
Really? You know, I would have been fine with that. My cousin is an albino, and they are regularly misunderstood and demonized in the media. Why didn't you?
Why didn't I what?
Have a representative from an albino group join us.
Oh, well, I figured it's not full moon, so...
Disgusting.
Oh, don't worry about that. That's just Ying's cooking. Oven Ying!
So, Leah, tell me. Do you like Tweed?
Fuck you.
Your microphones are still on.
I know.
That was affluent plagiarist Don White and a penniless, morally upright woman. Now, let's throw to... Oh, Tim and Fiona are back.
Stop that. Stop manhandling me.
I paid you $5,000 so I could manhandle you.
Not the first time he said that.
Now get in the kitchen!
Or that.
You don't want to be talking like that to me. I'm a fucking celebrity.
A local celebrity.
Ying, tell him what happens to people who piss me off.
I have awoken a sleeping giant.
I will fuck you all up while you sleep.
And now it's officially like Crispin's back home. Little Asian man and everything.
Okay. Andre, could you please go calm Fiona down while I get this last segment squared away?
Why me? I'm not trained for that.
You are her boyfriend.
No, that's in real life. In the continuity of the podcast, we haven't decided on a comedic throughline for our relationship yet, which is why earlier I was delusionally mistaking her for someone else, which Alistair had to rewrite into being simply a delusional obsession with her, but she didn't think that was as funny as the other running gag, despite essentially forbidding us from using it, and...
Well?
Well, now I don't know where we are, honestly.
Fiona, could you please describe your relationship with Andre?
Fleeting.
Is that the fictional one?
Well, in a way, they're both fictional.
Okay, on that note, let's throw to our final guest.
Guests, plural. Across from me right now is seated Lester Burr, who has been in a mental health facility for the past 6 years under the devout belief that he himself is Saint Crispin.
And across from me is Lester Burr, who has been in a mental... Wait, this is... Why are you handing me your cue cards?
I don't know. I don't want them.
Whatever. I'm going to go figure out if I'm dating Fiona or not. See if you can run this thing without running it into the ground, huh?
Oh, that's funny. You should go on tour with that. Someplace far away. Anyway, sitting across from me is the psychopath and his handler, Dr. Richard Casement.
Good to be here, Tim.
Now, Doctor, you're an expert in deviant psychology, is that correct?
That's right. I've devoted my life to intimately understanding and scrutinizing the behavior of murderers and sexual deviants.
Right. Do you mind if I ask what makes you different from them?
Oh, well, obviously I haven't acted on my urges. Yet.
Uh-huh. So, Lester, you must be excited about the holidays. Lester?
Remember, Tim, despite our best efforts, Lester adamantly believes himself to be St. Crispin. He doesn't know you're speaking to him.
Really? Even when I look him right in the eye?
I look my wife in the eye. It doesn't do any good.
Fine. St. Crispin, are you excited about the holidays?
I die and am reborn.
Do you?
He's actually very moody around the holidays. On St. Crispin's Eve, he relives being eaten by wolves.
Oh, and what's that like?
I am the savior unborn.
You know, Andre said having a dingbat from the wacko basket on the show would be a bit of fun, but this is getting kind of morbid.
Lester has killed people.
Has he?
People he considers to be his twin brother, like St. Crispin did.
And are there many people out there who look like Lester?
Oh, yes, if you don't take faces into account. Which I never do, for example.
What do you mean you never do?
Nothing. Do you live alone, Tim?
The flesh peels from the marrow.
And on that note, why don't we check in with Taiman Fuquan at the Tacoma Dome? How's it going, homie? Hello? What's going on over there?
Hello.
Who's this?
It's little Simon.
What? Oh, the kid with the old people bones.
Yep.
Where's Taiman?
He started going through heavy cocaine withdrawal and opened, paranoid gunfire on one of the phone operators.
What? Really?
Yeah, and he's barricaded on top of the ornamental money counter thing and he's taken the endangered Timberwolf, hostage.
Oh, okay. So, good to see the wolf then, did you?
Yeah, and Taiman shot his handler with the Gat 9, so now it's free, except it's a hostage, but it's free.
That's what America's all about, isn't it, son?
My disease wouldn't hurt so much if I didn't also have childhood obesity.
And America's about that, too.
I'm taking all y'all motherfuckers with me, devil! Damn! Devil!
I have to go. No one's watching the SWAT truck.
I'm a burden for life!
All right, this is all getting out of hand. Andre, Fiona, what's with the food?
Ying did an acceptable job, considering how little he's had to eat this week.
This stuff tastes great. It's like a cowardly surprise attack on the taste buds.
Where is Ying?
Oh, he'll turn up. He's around here somewhere. He's just very small.
All right. Well, to close out the special, why don't we share in some of this food and each talk about what St. Crispin's Day means to us?
I'm from Soviet Russia. I'm an atheist.
And my contract says I only have to pretend to be here till the food is done, so I'm actually leaving.
What?
Don't you start with me. I'm starring in a TV movie about a sassy, wisecracking stripper with dignity.
Sounds classy.
It's based on a true story.
So, what? We calling this the end?
Well, we can't exactly call it the beginning.
Tragic. You know, the last holiday special we did, it had a climactic crowd-based finale. Here it's just you and me standing by a pile of delicious food that was baked by an old starving man and that will now get thrown out in the dumpster by the parking lot.
Hey, that's probably where he is, at the dumpster, waiting for all this food he cooked.
You think so?
Sure, it's the miracle of St. Crispin's Day.
Okay, well, why don't we cut to a song or something? You know, a seasonal song. Put an exclamation mark on the end of this thing.
We can't just cut to a song the audience knows isn't even written yet. That's not an exclamation mark, that's a question mark.
So what do we do?
I know a joke about rape.